4 o'clock right now, and welcome everyone, and good evening. Before I start, I would like to first pay homage to all the 20 officers, including the Jawans, and who laid down their lives while serving the nation. And I express my deepest condolences to their families. With so much going on, it has been tough for us. We have a pandemic at one side, and we have this disaster going on at the other end on our borders. My salutations to the brave hearts, and I pray to God that their soul rest in peace, because I promised Mr. Baswa and Well Ergon to moderate this session, and hence I am trying to fulfill my commitment here. So I welcome all viewers to this discussion on the touch-free workplace. Now, as we scramble our life in the post-pandemic world, what does it really take for us to prepare a workplace while protecting our health and our safety of the employees, which is entirely our responsibility? Now, companies are looking at a very different working strategies, and we are also trying to see that the restoration of the workplaces and the resuming of the workplaces is done in a very comfortable manner. So today we have this panel discussion to understand how we can make our workplaces more comfortable. And because it has been a knee-jerk reaction when the pandemic struck us, right? And what are we going to do in the long term? So these are the discussions that I'm going to have, because we have all got used to this terminology called the new normal. As much as I hate this term, as many of you out there would be, but this is something that we are going to be living for a long, long time now. So here we are, and I welcome all my panelists for the day. Let me welcome with our first panelist, Ms. Pallavi from Adrian's, Mr. Giri from AstraZeneca. Please unmute yourself, panelists. Mr. Giri from AstraZeneca, Mr. Sachin Shastri from Dharmakaba, and Mr. Dinesh Reddy, Electronic Arts.
Hi, good evening, everyone.
Thank you very much, and I welcome you all. And I hope that our participants out here are going to benefit from this particular discussion, which is being put together by Mr. Baswa and Well Ergon. Thank you very much, because this is the first time we are in all the webinars we've been discussing so far. This is the first time we're trying to make sure that our workplaces are going to be touch-free. So I'm very interested, and I'm very keen to hear from you all. But before I jump on to the questions that are there for you, request you to briefly introduce yourself, and starting with the young lady here, Ms. Pallavi Srivastava.
Thanks, Major Aditi. My name is Pallavi. I work for a company called Adrian's. We are a workplace design and design and build firm. I have about 15 years of experience in the industry. So actually, I'm not so young. I'm a writer. I have published a book a few years ago on design and architecture. I am very active in the industry. So I'm actually quite active member for Fornet, and I'm also a very active member for Crew Network. It's a organization which promotes CRE women leadership. So that's in a nutshell. But I write a lot on workplace and design thinking, actively, and I sort of actively encourage people to come forward and, make it into a fruitful conversation. Obviously, we are living into, and what Major Aditi said, that we are not, it's a new normal, it's a new abnormal. So we are still finding answers to all of it. So thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. Over to Mr. Dinesh Reddy. Thank you, sir.
Hi. Yeah, good evening, everyone. Myself, Dinesh. I work for a company called Electronic Art Games, EA Games. So I work as a workplace experience manager for EA Hyderabad office, and with an experience of close to 10 plus. I worked with a couple of multinationals like Honeywell in the past. Those are my assignments, excuse me. So yes, like as Pallavi has mentioned, so it's new abnormal. So we have to accept it, and like as everyone, we are learning to live in this. So that is that's my view on this. Like, we are, everything is just evolving in terms of the way we are planning, trying to live, and the way we are planning to design our workplaces, create solutions, adapt to new change. Yes, so
over to Mr. Giri.
So we all look forward to.
Yes. Yeah. Over to Mr. Giri. He's from AstraZeneca. Sir, over to you, please.
Yeah, good evening to you all. I'm Giri from AstraZeneca. I head the facilities for AstraZeneca. I'm into this to facilities management now for at least 15 years. Prior to that, I was working with Indian Air Force. I've been into operations and maintenance of ground equipment throughout my career, including facilities. While I'm working now in facilities, and before that, even with Indian Air Force. Prior to joining AstraZeneca, I've been working with Caterpillar, HSBC, and IndusInd Bank. COVID is something like what others have spoken about. While people call it as a new normal, I say it is going to be a new routine soon. You'll have to live with COVID sometime now, at least till the vaccine is ready, or even if the vaccine is ready, this COVID is still going to be there in the society. And you need to know how you'll have to manage with COVID along with you by being more more proactive in the way we change our lifestyles in terms of personal hygiene and maintaining those social distancing, let it be at your workplace or let it be even outside the workplace. So I would call it as more as a new routine than a new normal.
We are anyways very hopeful, Mr. Giri, because we're looking forward for the vaccine to soon come out, and AstraZeneca, I believe, is the front runner. So we'll keep our fingers crossed, but we're all banking on your company for sure. Thank you very much for the introduction. Mr. Sachin Shastri, over to you, sir.
Good evening, everyone. This is Sachin here. I come from a company called Dormakaba. I have been in the industry for almost 2 decades now. And yes, I've gone through various markets, worked on different types of projects. In Dormakaba, I presently handling the assignment of specification, architectural specification. A brief about my company. We are a company that operates into architectural hardware, and I am Mongeri. We provide solutions which are not just smart but also secure for the industry today. So I come from that as a background, and yes, looking forward to probably learning more on this call than giving out. But yes, learning a lot is going to happen here. Over back to you.
Thank you very much, everyone. All of us hearing your introductions, you all made me feel very, very old. So for those of you who do not know me, my name is Major Aditi. I'm an ex-army officer. Some of you already know me, and I have almost about more than 2 decades, 26 years of service. I'm trying my best to keep up with the young generation out there, like Pallavi and everybody else. I try to keep my hair colored at all times, even in the lockdown. But yes, the intent is that let's keep the fraternity together. And thank you, Baswa sir. This is probably the third session that I'm doing with you. A lot of us have gained the insight into how we have worked through the lockdown from the very start with Infra. Yes, thank you, Sohil and Mandeep, if you're on the call, if you're not, and to others as well across the industry. So guys, I know that you're all 154 participants, as I can see, have been really working hard for your organizations. And now that we have a good set of people out here and the SMEs on the subject, from the design world and from the corporate world, my first question is definitely going to Mr. Dinesh Reddy and Mr. Giri. Now, when the pandemic hit us, sir, so what was your first POA, your first plan of action? Now, with the orders of the WHO, as you know, they have been flowing in what needs to be done, what doesn't need to be done. How did you all react to it from the corporate perspective, from the industry perspective, and what happened thereafter? Or even during the lockdown. So over to you, Mr. Dinesh. So what was your first reaction when it came to coordinating for your facility? Yeah. Mr. Giri, go ahead. This question was for both the corporate players, Mr. Dinesh Reddy and Mr. Giri. My first question was, I believe Mr. Giri would have heard, what was your reaction when the pandemic hit us? You know, what did you go through and what are the things that you kind of took care of?
Okay, so while personally also myself, while this coronavirus hit China, from the time we have been tracking what this virus is all about, and we initially tried to insulate ourselves as an, like, so we stopped the international travels initially, and then after that, when the virus started becoming into a medical emergency, then epidemic, then a pandemic, we saw that this virus is going to be pretty dangerous to every human, humans in this world, and it reads a kind of a real action as a crisis, then more than an emergency. So we started working, forming a group, a crisis management group initially itself. And so in the month of March, we were almost ready with what action should be taken. So while we got the first case reported in India, that's when we started putting our plans into action. We understood this virus well initially by knowing that this virus can be infected, can infect another person only through contact. So it is very necessary that you minimize contacts inside the facility. So the employee touch points have to be minimized. So we started working on understanding what are the common areas that an employee would usually touch, or you get a frequent touch points inside the facility. So we started focusing on those areas of disinfecting them very often, and also we try to understand the overall organizational work structure of understanding how employees would work inside the facility, and accordingly we started placing even hand sanitizers at strategic locations inside the facility. These were the initial reaction to the pandemic, but yeah, as and when the pandemic started growing more in India, we started taking stance of should we really operate from office as of now, and even before the government could declare a complete lockdown, we were already working 100% from home. And this 100% from home, we did it in a more staggered manner. We initially had some set of like around 35% of the people working from home, understanding the challenges that they are facing while working from home, making those changes in our operations, and then we declared 100% work from home. Like even before the government could declare a complete lockdown in all over the country, we were already ready for taking up this pandemic working from home.
It wouldn't surprise me, Mr. Giri, because you come from a pharmaceutical company, and of course you were much well aware of what was happening across the globe and how dangerous it could have been. Very sure that you took the right stand. Mr. Dinesh Reddy, over to you. So your thoughts, sir, what happened during the lockdown? What was the first plan of action? Are we facing a problem with Mr. Dinesh Reddy? I'll come back to you, Mr. Dinesh Reddy. So taking on from there, Pallavi, this must have been very, very challenging for you, because all of a sudden the entire world. How did your organization begin to redefine, you know, the workplaces and redesign them? You know, can you just throw some lights, keeping in mind the webinar that we have for today? So your inputs are very important for us.
Thanks, Major Aditi. Actually, I think as a workplace design community, this is absolutely a, and I wanted to just state one statement before I actually go to the design part, that we have to acknowledge that, you know, work from home is not something we are, we have suddenly found a new love to. It's something we suddenly found ourselves in a crisis in a very short span of time. And I think what everybody is also saying, that, you know, we saw it kind of coming, but we did not know that it's going to sort of blow out of proportion so quickly. And I think that's why I think all of you will agree that all organizations had a very short amount of time to react to and kind of put people back home and, you know, sort of provide them tools so that they can still work. And however, if you sort of talk to all the designers, we actually realized that, you know, there is a concept called, which my previous organization, Cushman and Wakefield, had put together, 6 feet office concept. What it does is every design element is sort of configured around the 6 feet idea. So what you're doing is you actually take the facility and you kind of realize the, you do the gap analysis where the office space is and how those, physical distancing. I refrain from using the term social distancing because it means different things. So what we had to counter is that we need to maintain physical distancing as much as possible, and we have to minimize the touch points. Now, unfortunately, we were thinking that when you start going with touchless kind of a scenario, you can go and do a whole lot of things in your office where you can make everything, you know, touch free. However, from the time you leave your house to your building, there are several things which you cannot like the car or a cat that you sit on, the handle that you open, you know, your door. And I think that's where the caveat comes in, you know. So we have to go and make sure that it's becoming more and more, or, you know, sort of, you know, disinfected and, you know, decreasing the amount of touch points. However, I don't think we can go 100%, you know, sort of, you know, but there are various tools that have come about. And I think what we have been talking to our clients, saying that we can come and look at your workplace. We will do a gap analysis with this old physical distancing and making it absolutely, you know, at least COVID ready as much as possible. So you create those occupancy scenarios in your floor plan, that how do we kind of, you know, so for example, if there are, you know, linear desks, can we take out, you know, every alternate desk so that there is a increased, you know, distance between the people? Can we have some kind of screen guards, you know, in front of people, you know, then so that there is no sort of, you know, touch there happening. And the one more important thing, I think it was important to sort of educate the employees, you know, to when they are coming and entering the workforce, can we create a very good quality, you know, graphic and signages across the offices, that where should they enter, where they shouldn't be entering, you know, how to keep that distance, because it's not something, a very usual thing, right? And there is a lot of fear attached to it. And I think there were a lot of technology tools that have come into play. And I think we are still learning, and we're still trying to say, how do you kind of, you know, when you enter the building, right? When you're doing you're still having your access card, you kind of place it, you get in, you get into the elevator. How do you, you know, these are real-time challenges. And I think all the companies so far, I have seen that they have kind of experimented with 10% to 30% occupancy. And I think we are still sort of coming up with a lot of new ideas and design solutions as to what will work for them.
Yeah. So I believe you have a bigger challenge at hand, because, you know, if you actually take out one of my workstations, I'm going to be falling short of seats, Pallavi, right? So, you know, this is going to be a huge challenge for people out like you out there, because we're never going to compromise on our seating capacities as well. Coming on to Sachin, sir, because she just mentioned about the technological advances. Very keen to understand from you. I believe in the world of technology, you've done some amazing work. I would like you to share with us about, you know, how we've gone about making our workplaces touch-free. All, you know, the platform is all yours, sir. So please share with us.
But coming straight to the point from the technical perspective, you know, ma'am, first of all, yes, a big thank you for that question, because it's something that relates to the work that we do. Yes, but coming back to the point on, in terms of a technical perspective, and coming from an experience, you know, once we entered the lockdown, we have been interacting with so many customers, you know, with an experience of almost more than 100 webinars that we have been doing for architects, builders, contractors, project management consultants. We have been doing this. One thing which has been very, very clear is that everybody today is looking at providing safe and hygienic environment for their employees. this is something that is becoming very evident. It's not just about trying to safeguard the other interest, but more so to see how the environment inside the offices, inside the public areas can be safe and hygienic. There are various ways of doing this, but the most important that comes to our mind today is how can we avoid touch points? And if we can reduce the number of touch points, then we can definitely reduce the spread of microbes. That's a known fact that all of us agree. One of the biggest questions is identifying areas where this needs to be done and how this needs to be implemented. In terms of implementation, companies might decide that yes, this is a good solution. It might cost them, and companies might even take that as a step to invest for the benefit of their employees, for the benefit of all visitors also who would probably visit their offices. They might do that investment. But the important question here is ease of use, ease of adaptation, cost factors, and of all things, the acceptance of people to use it. So I might have something that I'm saying that, people need to use something in a certain manner. The acceptance of people to agree and align to use it, that also becomes a very important factor. And that's one of the things which our clients have been talking to about, like, you are coming up with so many solutions, but how is it that our employees or our customers or our vendors or our visitors, and how are they going to use and experience? And that's one of the points which we are looking for.
All right, sir.
Yeah, back to you, ma'am.
So from a health perspective, from a health perspective, and I'm throwing this question to each one of you. So Mr. Dinesh, I think we had lost you for a while. So Mr. Dinesh, from a health perspective, how does a workplace design, look like in a post-pandemic world? So Pallavi has already said, there are going to be screen guards up. But what happens for all the employees coming back onto the floor? I know for a long time, we may not really have the 100% strength. So what happens then? Do we have Mr. Reddy on call? Mr. Reddy, I can see you.
Looking at that. So yes, so if you really...
I can't see you though. I think we can't see you though, but we can hear you. So please go ahead. Yes, now we see you. But now we don't see you.
Right.
All right. So...
Okay, I think there are some bandwidth issues. Sorry for that.
Yeah, so this is what's going to happen when it's going to be a touch-free workplace. So I think one of the first and the foremost things is going to be that since we are all going to be virtual, even when we're going to be sitting out of our places in the office, and hardly there are going to be any, face-to-face meetings. This is where I think the technology needs to really, really upgrade themselves. So Mr. Dinesh, I still can't see you, but I can hear you. Over to you,
right.
Sir.
Yeah. So as most of us are aware that, like, we used to have a 5x5 desks, which are tall and like where we can't see others. That was the starting stage, like where most of the offices have started. And slowly they have evolved with a greater idea of collaboration as a main objective to the linear desking or more open desking or most the modern offices what we see today. Mm-hmm. Right. So that was clearly to support an idea of collaboration within the workplace. So that was a trending word which was there in most of the workplaces that everyone now. Can I go ahead?
Unfortunately, Mr. Dinesh, I'm not sure we are really getting you very, very clear. I will move this question to Mr. Giri because we have people out here. So Mr. Giri, I'm coming over to you that how does your workplace design? I mean, have you made any changes to your current workplace? And I would request all our speakers and panelists to please keep their videos on. Workplace after the post-pandemic, what are the changes that you're planning to do? How is it going to look like?
Okay, so the post-pandemic scenario is not going to be the same that when we went back to home. Surely there is going to be changes in terms of maintaining, so your design should incorporate what you call the physical distancing between two people. So surely the desk allocation might change as of now, but the future designs might give more room for each employee. While I remember when I started my career, per person square feet per employee used to be between 110 to 120 per employee square feet, but slowly it started shrinking, and today there are many organizations which even operate at a 60 to 70 square feet per person. But post pandemic, surely the design will surely change. We might go even up to 150 square feet per person, ensuring that we are able to maintain that 6 feet between two people. And so while the design would change, but the basic nature of operations are not going to change. You need to be agile. You need to be fitting into all the latest production tools into place to be more productive at your workplace. So collaboration is going to be key. While collaboration, more of a virtual collaboration, is going to be on the stand for a longer time than more a face-to-face collaboration. But yeah, surely the number of meeting rooms might come down, because those are some common sources of contacts that employees can have. Away from more of a meeting rooms, but we would start having more of collaboration spaces, more of stand-up spaces, wherein we have virtual boards operated so that you are able to have some stand-up meetings, or very least face-to-face sit-up meetings are going to be there. So this designs will surely be there. While I look at the health perspective, I would not call it only as a physical health, but also as a mental health, because of greater social distance, the physical distancing that you're going to have between the workstations. Yeah, surely there is going to be lack of that social interaction that usually people have at a workplace. So there is going to be a drop in terms of that social collaboration that usually happens in a workplace. So we might need to look at ways, how are we going to ensure social collaboration even while we are able to maintain that 6 feet distance. Either we are able to bring some more virtual tools in place, or say even face-to-face interactions, maintaining the same social distancing. Probably today, many of the workplaces today, because of lesser square feet per person, we have the acoustics is so high because of the noise that might get generated. But when the distance between two people are going to increase, those acoustics are going to actually play counter to you when they try to talk at a 6 feet distance. So probably when the acoustics changes might happen even within the facility, you will not go for a very higher NRC tiles on the acoustic side. Wellness side, yeah, surely you might need to have those same exercise tools, that exercise workstations that you have, in terms of having those treadmills and those workstation cycles. But yeah, surely you might need to have more numbers in the office to ensure that there are lesser touch points within the office by employees. So these are few minor changes that might come, but overall you will surely see that the physical distance between employees are going to, in terms of workstations, are going to increase. So the square feet per employee, or the space for that employee, is going to increase. This is we need to look out how are we going to make them more productive with that kind of space, is something and challenge which every workplace manager is going to have.
I think one challenge that comes to me as an FM head or a manager or whatever it is, talking about workplace design, and I see one question from Prashant on the chat. What happens to the restrooms? How many you're going to throw out of your washrooms? How do you plan to do that? And what exactly have you done? So Dinesh, I'm going to come to you, because you're also managing your facility. What did you make any changes during the lockdown, or when it comes to the future space, how has the plan changed, if at all? Because that is something that our audience would like to really know. Has any one of you made any changes in your organization, and is any new new floor coming onto your organization that you're designing, or you were in the midst of designing, and then all of a sudden you went back to your IPC team and said, hello, excuse me, the pandemic is there. I think we need to change the doors. I think we need to do this. I think I need to do that. So Dinesh, over to you for your thoughts. And now don't vanish, okay? Because I've been trying to get hold of you for a long time. So make sure you're there holding the fort.
Right, fingers crossed. Right. So, yeah. Yes, so in terms of, while discussing with a lot of FM leaders around Hyderabad, so there were a lot of companies like where either they were ramping up with the business coming into city. On those lines, there is a lot of organizations were looking at in perspective of densifying the workplace so that they can leverage more from the existing space by optimizing the space. So that was a whole thought. So I was also on similar lines of looking at it. But the moment this pandemic has given an alert, suddenly the thought process has completely changed from densification to de-densification to provide more room, more space. So now most of the organizations are not really thinking about to extract maximum number of seats from a place. Now the whole point is it should be more airy and it should be the quality of air. So there are a lot of talking points which were never talked before. So those things have become a big talking points now. And in terms of, as most of the panel members have mentioned that there are a 6 feet distance or more than that if it's required, and virtual meetings. And there are so when I was going through a couple of webinars of North America, they are planning to create a virtual reality rooms. So where the moment if I wear the device and sit, I might be sitting just adjacent to that person. Mm-hmm. So as technology is really evolving, so I think how we will be adapting to it, that is one thing. And as Giri has told, yes, number of meeting rooms. So no one really would encourage meeting rooms. So collaborative spaces with a long, large distance space. So those might be few ideas.
So how does it change my numbers, Pallavi, Sachin? How does it change my numbers, my budgets? I mean, how are you going to help me fit into my budget when I'm going to make a touch-free workplace? Whether it is my existing workplace or whether it's going to be my new floor, I have a budget to work within, and with whatever is happening around the world, we still need to crunch more numbers. How do you help with us, to get this done? Pallavi, over to you.
So what I want to say is that, we have to differentiate that right now what we are doing is we don't know how long this is going to last, right? So de-densification is definitely a lot of people are looking at it, but it's also every time I talk to the business leaders, they're all also talking about the cost implication. The minute you start doing de-densification, the whole idea of bringing, X square footage, per person kind of thing, that's up for challenge. Now, there are a lot of business leaders that I'm talking, they're also talking about that through this experiment, post-experiment, they have realized that there is certain percentage of workforce can function from home if we provide them right kind of tools. Now they're also creating scenarios where they're saying that, okay, if they can function well and if they are okay, can we push 10 to 15% or somebody is creating a scenario of 25%. Can we put them in their work from home scenario for in coming days? Now that is one way to look at it. But the point is I want to bring here is that if you see last 15 to 20 years of evolution of office, right, from cubicles to the, all the enclosed, things, now we had moved all sort of open workstation area in last 5 to 7 years. Now, the very reason for doing that was that we were moving a lot towards a social space. Now that social space is now getting questioned because we have to now move away from each other. So the whole idea of why would you want to bring people to office if they have to sit in that isolated corner, which they can very well do it from, another location if it functions well. So I think there are two, three things we need to keep in mind that And I think Giri also pointed out that, you know, physical distancing and situation is still evolving, but we are, you know, the mental wellness of people, right? This is a kind of like an ecosystem which we are part of, right? Our offices, our organizations, we come, we... Now that part, how long can we, I mean, I think everybody unanimously has been telling me that we love the flexibility of working from home, but we cannot wait to even go back to our offices whenever given a chance, you know? So they're liking the flexibility of it, but we want to go because there is a social, you know, element to it. And I think I'm not going to sort of preemptively sort of predict, but I definitely, a couple of days ago, I was talking to somebody and they think suddenly people are, you know, going through this sort of a depression or grief. And I think they're saying that more and more the numbers are rising for infection. People are going and, you know, it was a blanket statement that some people are now jumping and, you know, like, you know, going toward taking the extreme step. So I think that part we need to sort of keep in mind that while we tackle this as a tactical thing of physical distancing, where that's the need of the hour, but I don't think that's a very long-term, you know, solution. So up until we find the vaccine, we will be doing a lot of experiments, what works for us and what doesn't. And I think we will have to do all these clinical things of, you know, sanitizing, you know, antimicrobial, you know, surfaces, keeping as much distance as possible. So taking, you know, alternate desks if that works. But, you know, businesses are going to also see from the cost perspective. And I think invariably, a lot of leaders that I've spoken to, they're all saying that cost-wise, it won't make sense to have, you know, whatever we used to have, 70 or 80 or probably 100 square feet per person, we can't afford to have 200 you know, square feet per person kind of a scenario. So I think it's something too soon to predict, but I definitely feel that we'll have to give it a few more days to sort of come out with multiple experiments, because employee safety and health is the prime agenda on everybody's mind right now. So that's where my, you know, I don't think anybody has been quite able to figure out all the answers. Major Aditi, I have to say this, and I think all of us
that's true. Yes, Giri sir, I will come back to work the corporate plan, but I want to take the views of, you know, from the other side of the fence. So Sachin sir, because you've been building up a lot of things for your clients, how has been your experience? Because you know, there's a lot of money flowing out as well from our pockets. We are all kind of getting a little anxious because we want to make a lot of things turn into, you know, with a magic wand that don't touch here, don't touch there. So how are you helping, you know, parallelly to make sure that, you know, something can be compromised with, something can be, and at the same time maintaining that balance? How easy or difficult it has been for you?
Let me answer it this way, ma'am, that as soon as the pandemic started, and then there were things that came out on what needs to be done, how should we keep ourselves safe. And one of the things that was definitely spoken about was about personal hygiene. It's like, you know, washing your hands, sanitizing, wearing masks. So there are so many things that were spoken about. Now, when we started looking at it from a perspective of what how employees would respond to this, I think, as we say, that personal hygiene is important. There are very high chances that sometimes this can also get compromised. It could also be that somebody needs to be in the office at 9 o'clock and he's just got a minute. Now he doesn't have a time to probably sanitize his hands and he's going to run in. Now this is a small compromise, but incidentally, the situation today is that the pandemic is totally unforgiving, and at the least chances, it takes it's extremely opportunistic on that. So one way of looking at it is by screening at entry points. Okay, and this is something that becomes very critical when we want to maintain the interiors or maintain the environment inside the office very clean. Screening becomes very important. And screening could be about, you know, whether somebody's worn a mask, has been sanitized his hands, has his temperature, what's the thing about it. Also in terms of, you know, how many people would be allowed, like what Pallavi ma'am was speaking about. How many people can we allow inside the office considering the distances that need to be maintained? So all these things are also important. Now today, all these things, whatever I've been speaking about, is happening on a manual, in a manual way. Like so there is somebody who's standing and taking readings and all those things. But for some reason, there can also be a chance of a human error that could come over there. And that is exactly why there are now auto. This process can also be automated, where the, at the entry point itself, you will know whether the person should be allowed to go inside or not. You find one small variation over there, you might want to send this person back home, or probably send him into a quarantine area, or probably take care of him in a certain manner. You know? So that can definitely be looked upon. Second thing which comes to my mind in terms of the solutions here, you know, from the healthcare perspective, is all that I'm speaking about. We speak about, you asked me about the toilet doors, you know, but my worry on the toilet door is much lesser, because to reach the toilet, somebody has to first enter the main entrance itself, and that is where it is going to be. So one thing which we have definitely been speaking about is that if it has to be touch-free, then we have to first see how many people are using it. The higher the frequency, the more prone that door becomes to be made into touch. So the doors which are extremely, you know, have a very high frequency, those are places where we look at touch-free solutions. Otherwise, we can definitely look at other solutions which could be hygienic touch solutions. When I speak of hygienic touch solutions, man, these are solutions which where, you know, it is not touch-free, but there is an indirect touch. It could be that you are using an accessory to probably push the door open, pull the door open, or might be to turn the handle. So something like that as an indirect touch. So that is also something that people can look at. Coming to the point of you asking, you know, how are you going, in what way are you going to spare our pocket? So let me say it this way, that if we look at solutions in the right manner, across a particular facility, you know, we had some of our customers just a few days back, and we showed them some solutions, and they said, okay, make all my doors touch. And okay, I said, okay, we'll do it touch free. We gave them the budgetary proposals, but one look at the budgetary proposals, and the proposal three, you know, went flying outside the window. And we were sure that that's exactly what will happen. But when we gave it a rational thought, then it was only the main door, the toilet door, the cafeteria door, and these were the three main areas where we needed to convert the doors into complete touch-free applications. Everywhere else, we had other solutions possible. Many cabins were just left open. You know, they said, we are okay with the open cabin policy over here, if that supports our requirement. If at all cabins need to be closed, then they can always be opened using hygiene solutions. So it's always about an approach. It's not a blanket approach to the whole thing. It's about understanding where what needs to be used, how it needs to be used. Speaking of main entrances, most of the main entrances today are secured. So every time somebody comes, he has to show his card and then go and turn a handle and then go inside. So if you have to make this door touch-free, the first thing you'll have to look at is what is it that you're going to do on the handle part. So, that, you know, it's a very different approach over here. A certain amount of knowledge in terms of what can be done without compromising on security is also important. So I think these are my views, man, and I'm sure I've answered a few points beyond what you asked.
So I will move on to Mr. Giri for his views, but before I move, ask him to actually talk, so this is just a red flag to all the participants out here. The technology demands that I will have to restart my system in another 6 minutes and 35 seconds. So if I am going to fall off this call, I will make sure when my system is getting rebooted, I join this call again, whether it is from my mobile or whether it is coming back onto the system. And in that time, I will request the organizers to please play the video from Mr. Sachin Shastri. But in the meanwhile that I joined back. So just a heads up for everyone. So I'm not vanishing like Mr. Reddy. I'm just giving you a heads up. So Giri, sir, your thoughts, please.
So to add on to what Pallavi was talking about, the new space, how are we going to save cost in terms of the CRE, that the real estate that we might need to carry with the amount of physical distancing that we need to provide inside office. I've been working on a kind of a model called as an hub and spoke model. While we can retain the same office with enough physical distancing, but at the same time, we need to also look at people working from home. This work from home actually has brought in a lot of opportunities for organizations in terms of that experiment which we have been talking about for a long time. The crisis has actually brought that experiment into a live reality, and it has proved that it can work for several of the organizations. So many of the organizations are today looking at work from home as one of the very best option for workplace management. But so while you maintain the same office that you are in, maintain the physical distancing, but at the same time have some spoke locations wherein you have small offices of 5 to 10 seaters probably around the city, so that work from home people, if they need a collaborative meeting that needs to happen, or a physical person that is required to connect to the mother network of the organization, these kind of spoke locations can actually help it. And also it will not basically impede on your excess cost that you might spend up expanding a new floor with too many capital involved in it, and also the real estate space that you would start engaging in. So I'm kind of aligned towards the new, probably a very very different method in real estate called the hub and spoke model, which probably could become a success in the coming days as we explore more about this kind of an RE model, which is not that popular today, but yeah, soon this could become a possibility for many of the organizations. And while speaking about Mr. Shastri's remarks on the places that you might need to identify which has frequency, better frequency, as a facility manager you need to be understanding your employee movement inside the office. That's very important post pandemic when you open the office, to accordingly make your office touch free. So it's very important for every facility manager to understand the traffic of your employees and the timing of those traffics. If you see, cafeterias are usually having a higher traffic during the lunch times and during the evening snacks or the morning breakfast times. Otherwise you will not see the cafeteria that much occupied, but the restrooms are something which are usually having a higher traffic during the office hours, and your entrances are mainly more traffic during the start and end of the shifts. So it's very necessary that you understand such kind of traffic movement of your people, make them as read the traffics and kind of create hotspots within your facility. That will help you to actually focus which are the areas which you really need a complete touch free, which are the areas where you can have a partial touch free with help of any kind of a door puller or a door pusher kind of a thing, where you don't need to be even touching it. And there could be, certainly there are some areas which are very sensitive on a security perspective, where you need to keep those doors closed. Probably those are the areas where you can focus with help of your housekeeping on regular sanitization of those touch points, so that you can ensure that you are able to minimize touches by employees. Even if they touch any part in the facility, you are able to ensure that it is well sanitized and the workplace doesn't become a source of infection of COVID among the employees. So these are very necessary as a facility manager. You need to read through all this while you start opening your offices.
So my next question obviously is, you know, you've been working, and guys, I have already joined through my phone, so you're not going to see me absolutely gone. So that is one. So Mr. Reddy, over to you. You know, we've been hearing about these applications coming out, and one of the audience is very keen to know that, you know, have you tried to reach out to people to see how technically you're going to make sure that there are physical distancing, distancing maintained at workplace? What methodology have you applied? Now, when you ask me, let me be very honest to the audience here. If you ask me, we've just gone physical, in a sense that we've removed the extra chairs, we have a staggered approach on our floors. Obviously, none of the organizations as on date are even working, 10%, while the government orders are very clear, just work whatever you can right now when we're talking about unlock. But truly, since the systems have moved to the houses, the only effort has gone into making sure that my main doors are open, as everybody mentioned. You have a sanitizer in place where you're not even touching your bottles. Your safety kits have been issued to the employees, which are carrying your mask, your pair of gloves, your safety key. because I cannot change my building overnight. I just cannot make sure that, you know, I'm going to remove those doors and replace them. That is an involvement all over again. But whatever existing was with us is something that we did. When our employees were coming to work, and I do have employees coming to work, and probably one of the organizations which has been mute, my system is rebooting again. Just give me a thumbs up that you can see me, and I've still not gone offline. Perfect. All right. So in continuation, so I've removed my chairs from the places. Every individual is sitting with a 6 feet distance or even more. We are ensuring that we are following the MHA orders. When it comes to even food, eating of the food, we've given permission to have people to bring food from home. I bring my own food from home, in fact, including the cutlery. But because we have people working in the night, we are also ensuring that we serve them food, which is, of course, very hygienically provided to them. Same things that we've done. So in a way, even coming to your access activation, deactivation, you know, your biometric access, they've all gone. The doors are kept open, ensuring that safety is in order. When it comes to health and safety of the employees, disinfection happens on a very continuous level with a distance, with a gap of about a couple of weeks. We make sure we do that. And rest, I'm not getting into the details because there's a lot of effort that every organization has done, and I have done it too as well. Now, coming to Mr. Reddy, so I need to know that, you know, how you have prepared your site and what effort is going into making your touch-free workplace. So Mr. Giri shared that, you know, they're also looking at it. Pallavi said it's not going to be a one-day time. Mr. Sachin also said that, you know, clients have their own reservations, but when you approach the subject in a very systematic manner, because this is not going to be a short-term plan, it's going to be a long-term plan. So how is your organization, Electronic Arts, looking at it?
Major Aditi, we can't see you though, huh? Your video is off.
My video is off?
Yeah, we can't see you. We would love to see you.
Oh my God. So this is highly unfortunate. The camera, it says this meeting. So no worries. My system is restarting. Hear my voice, ladies and gentlemen, for the timing, because I said my system is rebooting. There are technological requirements. There are some software patches that have been updated. So over to you, Mr. Reddy. See, for a minute, I'm giving you company. Now I vanished for a while.
Reddy is not here.
Okay, I think we've lost him again. So Pallavi, I need to have certain success stories from you. I would be very happy if you can share your success story or your failures during this lockdown. And I'm going to move this question across the board to Sachin, to Giri, to Mr. Reddy again. So your success story and your failure and your share of experience during this lockdown.
So, I mean, that's a very great question, but I don't think I have a great answer to that. I think definitely I think that the clients that were working with, you know, and I have to say that it's such an accelerated mode of, you know, so what happened is clients were coming and they actually, a lot of questions were coming from the infrastructure point of view. So they were just looking at, you know, their systems are working fine, their broadband, you know, all these things which were supposed to be the, you know, the nut and bolts of, you know, putting people at, you know, at home working. That was one part, but I think slowly I think started to realize the limitations of, you know, working. Like, for example, ergonomics became a challenge, you know, then not having a proper segregated space in their homes was a challenge, because it's not the same, like, you know, we have smaller apartments, we have smaller houses and more people living. And I think that was an immediate challenge that kind of, you know, came out of it. And I definitely feel that, you know, coming up with a footprint of this, you know, because right now we are just hoping, everybody is hoping that by early next year we will have a vaccine and we can at least go back to our some of the lessons that we learned and go back to our usual office spaces. But my worry is that if it prolongs more than that, then it will have long-term implications. But because already a lot of clients are looking at, you know, cost-saving perspective. Now, in that case, we will have to, as a design community, go back and relook at the entire design that we used to, you know, design offices with. Now, like, I think, we spoke about the hub and spoke models. I have, I have been sort of thinking about the one definitely idea that came to my mind was that can we think of work from anywhere concepts? So let's say today I get up and I say, today I have these kind of things I need to do. I'm going to spend this much time at home, this much time in office, and this much time can I go somewhere else? Mm-hmm. Work from home, work from office, and work from anywhere, sort of a cafe. So can that model be a successful, and it can be, can it be productive for an individual? And that is something I think needs to be seen. And I think that, you know, flexibility is very, very important. So we won't be able to prescribe that you have to work, you know, X way, you know, in the office or X way at home. And I think a lot of have to come up with a lot of flexible options given to their employees. And I think that one last thing I want to just sort of say that, you know, I actually was today, just today morning, I was one of the companies trying to monitor their employees with a tool to see how much time they spend working, you know, and kind of what they're doing on the screen. And I felt that was such a inhumane way of treating your employees, because imagine you being sort of monitored by a tool, a video or something, the kind of time you spent. And that's where I think a lot of conversation around trust will have to be taken very honestly across the board. I don't think it's okay. Conversation. Yeah.
So I also see Baswa, you're busy cycling on your work desk. This is not a part of your touch-free workplace for sure, but it's very good to see that you're maintaining yourself very healthily. So thank you very much for making us envious of what you're doing at your workplace. Mr. Sachin, what has been your journey in the lockdown and your failures? And you know, I'm very keen to understand failures, because this is something that has become our learning chapters. And we know the successes, right? But I want to understand your experience during this journey.
Okay, I'm somebody who always likes to talk about success, but yes, you can never have success without failure. So I accept this question too. One of the things which definitely happened after the lockdown started, and then we were trying to understand what it is that we can offer as solutions. So as a spurt, as a knee-jerk reaction, we had products. We just picked up something, we didn't go, as in, you know, it was not going in person, but of course, we connected to our customers and then we tried to do something and understand solutions. But believe me, the biggest failures that we faced was always about not understanding what is required of us. We used to understand in terms of, you know, the technology that is required. We could understand what which wires have to go where, what wires have to come out, which nuts have to be tightened, and which screws need to be loosened. We could understand all those things. But the most important part which we learned as we went ahead was about the ease of use, was about how people are going to respond to usage of these products and systems that we would provide. Is it going to affect security in some manner or not? When I speak of security, that becomes very important, because the fact that there is an access control today on a particular door, that definitely means that there is a certain security threat which needs to be addressed to also. And it could also be, you know, as you said, ma'am, that, you know, considering the situation today, you have kept some doors open, but you have kept the doors open, but you have not moved your watchful eye away from those doors. But if the access control is in place, you will probably have focus your attention on other things also. So our learning out of the experience has been that if these are situations that need to be addressed, then first we have to understand what is it that the customer wants and how is it wanting it. So being able to provide solutions on that, that has been our biggest learning. It could be, you know, the ability to assess and provide fast solutions. It's a retrofit. You spoke about, ma'am, changing of doors. My question is, why change doors if you can retrofit something and still make it workable? So if that is possible, that resolves a lot of issues. Most importantly, other than that, things which came up was about, the security requirement. Some people required a certain type of lock only. And now we want it touch screen. We need to change the lock. And then somebody says, we cannot change the lock. It needs an approval. So we're coming in from an approval. I think there's a big echo.
Somebody can just put them on mute, that's all.
Audible now?
Yes, audible.
Yeah, the last point I was speaking about was about, there's an access control lock and we cannot change the lock because it's a security protocol. It's something that needs to get approval probably from some office which is within India or might be somewhere abroad. And approval process is a long process, it takes a long time, but the situation at ground is immediate. Mm-hmm. It's not immediate, it is something that was wanted yesterday. And we are already 2 days late. So these have been learnings that we have gathered over the last few months.
All right. I'm also going to keep a time check. We are 3 minutes up five. So Giri, sir, very quickly, your failure. I don't want the success. I need to know your failure.
Failures are like, we did not foresee the lockdown to extend for so long, which actually we did not foresee, like we need to be putting too much of focus on mental well-being. We picked it up very late, but now we are online. We are focusing a lot on the mental well-being of employees, which is very critical during this lockdown. So that was the only failure that we foresee. We did not actually foresee when we returned back to home.
Yeah, I think many of us failed in that aspect because we were so busy trying to do business continuity. Trying to get our systems in place and making sure that in case you're going to operate, just make your place worthy of someone coming down to the floor, that he doesn't feel uncomfortable. In fact, the situation has also reversed in our case because employees do want to come to work because they feel a little safe around here as well. Over to Mr. Reddy. Your failure, sir. Okay, I think I seem to have permanently lost Mr. Reddy. Now, I would request...
Yes, some network challenges. So
no problem. So thank you very much for your inputs. To the audience out here, thank you for being with us. I'm going to just have a video played by Mr. Sachin Shastri. I would request the organizers to play this video for the benefit of all of us. And thank you all. Had a good heartfelt conversation and wishing you all well. So here goes the video.
Yeah, this is more a presentation that I just wanted people to know. You know, this is what we spoke about, all of us, from touch to touch free. Safe flow measures require us to look at another option of not touching the door and still being able to open it. Next. So I was speaking about an integrated solution. I was speaking about a holistic solution. It has always got to be in a manner that it works, in tandem with whatever is the requirement.
Audible, clear?
Am I audible clearly now? Yeah. So it was always about giving solutions. So it could be the main entrance of the building or next solution. Srinivas, next. Yeah, it could be installed in this manner, or it could be know, this could be the other solutions that can come through. These are different solutions I'm just presenting to y'all. Okay, can we have the next slide? It could be requirements of swing doors that are required. One thing which comes that you can see on the right side, it could be segregation of the entry and the exit. You know, so we ensure that there are two different doors, so it is not, people are not coming and facing each other in at the entry and exit. I know this is not going to be possible in all locations, but where it is and where, even if it demands a little amount of a reroute, I think that reroute makes sense. In meeting rooms where you don't want to touch doors, it could be different applications that can be put in place, and you can make those doors also as touch-free applications. Next slide, please. Next slide. Yeah, this is one more way that we can look at. Next slide. It could be using all the doors probably with a remote that we can do. But every time that we speak about it, always has to be solutions. Solutions where, you know, if you look at the right side image over here, it speaks about a remote control and how the door would operate. But what is unseen over here is the safety sensors and how safety can be maintained and how those things can be put in place. And now those are things where an experienced team is required. An experienced team from the facility, an experienced team from the vendors too. And it's only a combination of that that can support us. Can I go? Can we have the next slide, please? We were talking about next slide, please. Yeah, we were talking about toilets, and when it comes to toilets, it's always going to be very important over here to ensure that these doors are touch-free. Why touch-free? Because people go inside, they use, they come out. Sometimes hands are wet, sometimes hands are dry, sometimes somebody misses to do something, and chances of an infection, chances of a spread of infection. Or microbes is very high, and that's what makes these doors extremely important to be made as such. So let's look at a small video here which will support us. Next slide, the video, please. Play the video, Srinivas. Yeah, so you can see people walking inside over here, and you know, they come inside the store and this running as they operated, and this lady is now going to the toilet block. The main entrance to the toilet block is an automated door. It operates on a radar, but when it comes to the particular door, it need not operate on a radar. It needs to open only for the person who intend to enter into that place, and that is possible using a contactless way switch. And this is exactly how it operates. People show their hand, and the door opens for them. When this person goes inside, finishes her work inside, and when she wants to exit, at that point in time also, she just throws her hand and exits. So this is one application that can eradicate the usage of touch as an application there. Of course, sensors need to be built in to ensure safety is kept at the right level. Going ahead, it could be also important to know how this applies to a physically challenged toilet door. Very important function. What you are going to see here is a person who is normally abled, not a disabled person, but this can also be important for a disabled person. So this lady approaches, she shows her hand, and the door opens for her. She goes inside. Now, what happens from here is very important to know. Now, if it is a disabled person who's gone inside and he's going to use that disabled toilet, it's important for him to also lock this door. And that's what happens when she has shown her hand the second time from inside, the door got locked. And after she finishes her job, she just touches her hand or shows her hand to the contactless way switch, and the door opens. Now, when this door opens the second time, the LED outside becomes green. It had become red earlier and when the lock got engaged. So it gives you the privacy that is required, and at the same time, the ease of use without any complications. You don't need to touch anything. Everything can be hygienic. Everything can be clean. Everything can be touch-free, and it's possible. Let's have the next slide, Srini. We are running out on time. Next slide, Srini. Yeah, so it could be other applications which could be like main entrances where you have sliders or you have swing doors. So as we said, ma'am, that you know, we don't need to change things. We just need to probably do a retrofit measure. This is what we were talking about, the safe check, you know, what we can look at, right? Whether a person is using his hand sanitizer, body check, mask check, crowd control, or you know how many people can be inside. But matter of fact, all put together, this is how safe entry flows can operate. Okay, can we have the next slide? So it could be as simple as where this operates, you integrate it with all the main entrances of the office. You know. So this is how it operates. Let's go to the next slide, please. Now, this is a video where a person approaches, please run the video screen. He approaches, he goes to the door, but the door doesn't open for him. In normal times, the radar would have operated and allowed the door to open, but it has not. The reason being, he didn't sanitize his hands. Now he sanitizes. Only when he sanitizes his hands that the door will open for him. So this ensures that every time this anybody is going to enter that facility, his hands are going to be sanitized and only then he enters. So it's possible to do that. Next video, if tailgating is something that comes to your mind, you know, that people, two people might enter at the same time, we can also do something like this. They sanitize, they pass through. If two people sanitize, if one person has sanitized, the other has not, this sensor barrier will not allow people to go through. It will ensure tailgating measures are put in place and people don't tailgate over here. So that is also possible. Next slide, please. We look at various functions of the safe check tower. And now I'm going to just run a video which shows you the different functions which are possible. So this is how a safe check tower would ideally look. And yeah, this is done at one of our factories and it is just showing you how it runs. So he's sanitized and he goes through. Access control if required, that is possible. The crowd control part can be done. They can count how many people are going inside. If the number of people increases, then there's a sign that comes on and says, you cannot enter. You have to wait. Wait for somebody to come out and only then you can enter. So please excuse us on the flow of the video because it's all about internet connectivity. So if he's got one of mask, those things can be controlled. System settings are very easy. As I said, ease of use is the most important thing. If it is complicated, nobody is going to use it. If it is easy to use, everybody will use it. So these are certain things which we can put in place. Yeah, so mask check is possible. Temperature check is possible. Yeah, let's go to the next slide. No, go to the next slide, Srini. We are running out on time desperately over here. Go to the next one, Srini. From retrofit measures, touch to touch free in three steps. This is something that is possible. You will see a lot of this data coming up from our side onto LinkedIn, onto so many of the social media. We talk of three steps: remove, install, and install. You remove the mechanical parts, you install some sensors, you put in the automatic sensors, and just be done with it. But what's most important here is that you see three steps. But it's a team of people who come together and put all these things together, understand the requirements of what is there at site, what can be done, what cannot be done, wire you have, can we have this wire being seen, is it allowed, can we have this particular door removed, can how do we install this door back, what are the aesthetic features which might get disrupted by doing those things. So those are things which are important. As a team, the most important offering from our side is that the technicians who come to site, they understand this and they integrate the entire thing into your systems without compromising on security, without compromising on safety, and ensuring that it doesn't become an eyesore over there. So yes, these are solutions which are possible from us. Next slide, Srinivas. That's what I have to say. If there are any questions.
All right. Thank you very much, sir. I think this was a very, very informative presentation. And can we just switch off the... Srini, can you just shut this off and we can all come back? So thank you all. I think it's been very informative. And thank you for your inputs and your time. And to the audience, my heartfelt gratitude for being on the call with us. We've already overshot the time by 15 minutes. I leave you with a thought that this is the safety of the employees and it is your responsibility as the FMCRE and security heads. Please ensure that you are trying to put up your facts as far as, making your workplaces, whether it's going to be from the cleanliness perspective or hygiene perspective or from the HVAC perspective or even from the touch places perspective. Pallavi has shared about her design. She's mentioned that the 6 feet idea is a good idea. Giri sir has already mentioned that this is going to be the norm of the day. he does not really relate with the new normal perspective, but he says that this is how it is going to be. I'm sorry we could not have Mr. Reddy on the call for a very, very long time. Sachin sir, thank you for what you shared with us. It looks very exciting, and I hope that many of us can reach out to you and see how we can retrofit certain things. But from here, thank you very much, and I wish you all well, and I wish you all a very safe life. Very important for all of us while we've unlocked ourselves, but this is the time, and since we are here in Bangalore, so please take care. And to all the people who are there in Mumbai, Delhi, metro cities, non-metro cities, tier 2, tier 3 cities, please make sure that you are not letting your guard down at any point of time, and making sure that employee safety is first and foremost. Keep your places safe and clean. And of course, as someone said, mental wellness, be in touch with your employees. This is something where we all lack, right? So when we say touch-free workplace, I would say touch your employees as well. So thank you very much. That is all from my end. And I wish I could see everybody on the screen once. And that's always my last bit, that I like to see everybody on screen so that I can say my hi, hello, Jai Hind, and Namaskar to everybody. So to the organizers, if I can see everybody on the screen one last time. Guys, thank you for being there. Hello, everyone. And God bless you. God bless your family. Thank you. And thank you again. Jai Hind, sir.
You can all drop. Namaste. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you.